This video is sponsored by ISL. This is Nanaimo, the second largest city on Vancouver Island. It is known for the typical pickup truck culture, an iconic dessert, and for being, to many Vancouver yuppies, simply the place you land before driving to Tofino. But it's a city that grew out of the coal industry in the 1800s, building up around a rail line and later around the highway that followed. The result is a long, linear sprawl with a population density about a fifth that of Vancouver. But you shouldn't judge a book by its cover, because here they have been quietly implementing the kind of cycling infrastructure that every city across the continent should be laying down on their streets. Here, it's Dutch influence that is changing the urban landscape. And it's not just the street names like Amsterdam Crescent, Arnhem Terrace, or Tulip Place. Just a short ride from there, intersecting Bergen Op Zoom Drive, is what may be the best example of Dutch-style bike lanes in North America. When I was in Eindhoven last summer, I had the chance to meet up with Roy Simons, where we explored the city in search of some of the lessons we in North America could learn from Dutch street design. We got to talking about the best examples adapted on this side of the world, and Roy was keen for me to visit Nanaimo to see what is still one of the best examples of continuous sidewalks and bike lanes on the continent. So I met up with Mike Elliott, ISL's Mid-Island lead, and again by Roy, a sustainable transportation specialist. ISL is a multidisciplinary engineering firm in Western Canada and a leader in the planning and design of active transportation infrastructure. They've been working with the city of Nanaimo for many years, including supporting the city through the development of their award-winning engineering standards and the application of those standards on Metral Drive. There was, of course, much more to see, and Jamie Rose, the manager of transportation for the city of Nanaimo, was kind enough to take us on a tour of recent projects and provide some insights into the city's transportation infrastructure. Without further ado, let's start the tour, beginning here along Metral Drive.
So this is Metral Drive. This is kind of our flagship project stemming from the standards update. By classification, it's an urban collector, so kind of a mix of uses, but generally low density. We've got the separated pedestrian cycling realm, clearly defined travel lane.
This is by all accounts the best example of Dutch-style continuous sidewalks and bike lanes in all of the US and Canada. The brilliance of this design lives in its simplicity, by flipping the traditional priorities in the streets on its head. Instead of people walking or cycling down into driver space at intersections, drivers have to come up and over the pedestrian and cycling space. The design signals to drivers to slow down and be aware, which is aided by the vertical deflection, effectively turning the whole sidewalk and bike path into a speed bump. I have to admit, when I first saw photos of Metral, I wasn't blown away. But after taking off my orange-tinted glasses, I saw just how fantastic it was. I mean, if you put down some red asphalt, you might be hard-pressed to spot the difference. But what really blew me away was taking one good look on Google Street View, because Metral used to look like this.
Very rural, ditched road, probably 8 to 9 meters of asphalt. Cars just kind of did this down it. And they just sort of weaved left and right, and they had this massive territory that they could own.
The experience before the change would have been pretty uninspiring, to say the least. Not even a sidewalk to trundle along. But now, you will only find a traditional return to the road where major streets intersect, leading to a rather strange experience on a bike because, as you roll along, it's likely you won't even notice the intersections at local streets and driveways, as it's all so seamless.
I think the difference, I mean, when you're walking along here before, like half the time you didn't even have sidewalks, so that's obviously a huge upgrade, but imagine if it did have sidewalk and regular curb returns. You know, every intersection, you're down, up, you're kind of conscious you've got to look for cars, whereas you walk or ride along this section and you barely notice these intersections. And again, for the cars, they're now crossing the bike realm, the pedestrian realm. It's flipping the prior priorities on their head, I would say, but it's also designing it exactly to reflect the modal hierarchy, right? Yeah. Pedestrians should have priority, bikes should have priority over cars. This design is the most clear way of doing that.
These weren't the only improvements along the corridor. Islands were installed for safer pedestrian crossings, and here where Turner Road meets Metral, you'll find a Dutch-style protected intersection. And while all of this was welcomed as incredible improvements to many, it wasn't an immediate hit with everyone.
This corridor is very polarizing. The people who love it, love it. And all of the information we can kind of pull from it, the stats, the usage, all of those things are wildly positive, but we still have sort of this change management.
And I mean, even last week I was talking to somebody who I would generally kind of say is switched on. They're like, no, I don't like Metro. The words that I got out were complicated, I don't understand it, and I couldn't quite piece all those together. because as you come in, it looks like a driveway.
Yeah.
And so maybe if you're looking for a road, it's not like, oh, there was the road I was looking for, because you're looking for this traditional curb return where you can just wheel around it. But at all of our local roads, we've used this raised local treatment to give pedestrian priority, but also to give feedback to the drivers, you are entering a fundamentally a slow zone. Like, you are in a residential neighborhood now, so you're the guest, you're not the dominant, you know, user.
This is very much something drivers will become accustomed to over time. And it's actually a flip that came sooner than expected.
Pre and during construction, we're just absolutely 100%. This is ridiculous. What are you doing? I can't do this. It's changed, and on and on, and just negative. And there were a handful that actually followed up and went, you know what? You were right. Like, hang on, sorry. You want to repeat that for me? Because we don't typically get that kind of a response. Like, we'll get the support, we'll get the, hey, that's great, we love it, thanks for doing it. Or we'll get the resistance, what are you doing? This doesn't make sense, I don't like it. But having the acknowledgement that the change actually had the intended outcome is very uncommon from what I've seen.
This can't be understated, and it speaks to how great of a design it is. That being said, building such modern infrastructure comes with extra challenges. Despite vast benefits, communities are still trying to work around a Motor Vehicle Act that was written based on cyclists sharing the roadway with vehicles. As we build more protected infrastructure to aid mode shift, environmental affordability, and health objectives, people cycling and rolling are no longer operating on the roadway with vehicles and may have to be recognized differently by law when the MVA is updated. Before moving along from Metral, there is one last thing that has to be mentioned, because this isn't just a one-off. Continuous bike paths and sidewalks are now part of the engineering standards in Nanaimo.
It has a lot of standard stuff in there, like protected bike lanes, protected intersections that were already becoming, I would say, commonplace, definitely in Vancouver and other places in North America. But nobody really, except for maybe Canmore, had done a continuous sidewalk and bike path. So I think the city being the first to put it in their standards was a pretty cool thing, so that anytime they come to upgrade a street, it gets this treatment.
This means that even the uninitiated engineers and planners will be given the tools and direction to include human-centered design in the community. More of which we will see, because from Metro, we are headed downtown via Vancouver Island University to explore connections made and yet to be completed along the way, starting with an old rails-to-trails corridor.
This is the old E&N Railway, or the Squamish to Nanaimo Railway. So this used to run from Victoria up to, it actually goes all the way to Courtney and then out to Port Alberni. But in the 90s, the city actually created this multi-use path going from basically central Nanaimo up to Mostar Road, which ties into the Metro corridor. And then we're now working to go south and go through downtown and then connect into the Southgate neighborhood. And this has kind of been like the flagship, I guess, for a long time for active transportation. So it's nice. It's on like a 2% grade for most of it.
This is such a good like backbone of your like AT network.
Yeah, no, you got to applaud the folks who had the commitment and conviction to push it through 30 years ago.
At Bowen Road, we were met with a prime example of making the best with what you're given.
This was one of the pilot projects, yeah. So this is, I think, if you look at the provincial guidelines, this is falls into the constrained or very constrained categories. Typically, there would be a desire to have more separation between the modes. We just don't have the space here. And so this is really shoehorning in everything that we could possibly want to make it better. Oh, compared to a painted lane or just an extra wide curb lane, it's light years ahead.
Yeah.
And you know, I mean, a lot of folks will probably see the intersection and go, well, you know, there could be this or there could be that. There could be, but when this is just sort of a retrofit project, I think we're pretty proud of it. And as I say, it's sort of a version 1.0, and every project we learn and find a way to do stuff better, so.
We continued onward to a neighborhood that hosted a bunch of new design elements that will be a common sight in Nanaimo.
So this is, you'll see more of these further up, but this is an example of our raised local intersection treatment. But this is sort of where we sort of use this treatment to heighten awareness and increase prioritization for pedestrians to cross. So this is a new subdivision that ties into our new major capital project. We can see it all in kind of a ring, so. The other thing we did was made this raised intersection in the middle of it just to further kind of add speed management features. I think it works. It's not really operating yet. There's nothing built in here yet, but it is open. But from a walking, biking perspective, it's, you know, it shows that sort of prioritization.
This treatment is so common in the Netherlands, you might not even notice it when riding around. Much like how continuous sidewalks and bike lanes slow drivers, this does the same, turning the whole intersection into one big speed bump. These are safer for everyone, not just people outside of cars.
This whole corridor here in the early versions is actually the fourth leg of the roundabout to bring cars in here.
Yep.
And this is where we said, like, this probably isn't the best idea because you're just going to end up with people shortcutting through the neighborhood. So the cars go out and around. It's maybe a 15-second detour for a car, but peds and pedestrians and cyclists can just come right through here and they're onto the trails. And this is, it's not a bike facility. It's a facility for everybody, and everybody can kind of use it. And so, you know, this is sort of, you know, when you start to talk about like how things are done in the Netherlands and how things are done in Sweden and how things are done in Japan. How do people interact in each of these facilities? You know, when I was in Japan, I found it really interesting because pedestrians and cyclists and scooters and everybody can all coexist in a space. Yeah. And there's not this tension and friction and I don't know, just conflict.
Honestly, I think this area is going to be a pretty desirable neighborhood and families are going to want to be here. Just convenience of the grocery store, school, not too far from the highway. So you want to go anywhere, off you go, right? So my chiropractor's down there and his kids, they're maybe 14, 13, something like that. He never used to let them walk to Bebben Park by themselves, right? And now, product of age, but also he's like that intersection, they can get across with no concerns, right? So, and they can go to Tim Hortons. They've been pretty pumped about getting to Tim Hortons and like, but so just that freedom that you're now, you're not driving your kids to the park, you're not driving your kids to the Tim Hortons, they can just walk or bike or do whatever they're, yeah. And you have no real concerns about it, so.
Yeah, it's helping set kids up for like learning these life skills and in a supportive environment. Like this is something we've kind of, we're continually talking through with the school district. Like walking to school is a life skill. Being able to navigate outside of a car is a life skill.
One block over from the roundabout was this protected intersection with improved crossings and has even implemented no right on red, dedicated bike signals, and tactile surface warning indicators. Onwards, we came across a continuous multi-use path, an industrial area that had a repurposed parking lane, and I took the chance to ask Jamie about the modal share in the city.
Our statistics really haven't changed from the 90s. However, the volume of projects we've done in the last 7 or 8 years has been remarkable. And I think that this next census is going to be very different.
The most recent census in 2021 puts bicycle use at 1.4% or 3.1% of trips that include a bicycle. It'll be interesting to see how much that changes at the next census.
So this actually isn't a city road. This is a private strata road. It's interesting, when I ride through here, it kind of reminds me of some of the areas, not the greening and stuff, but the sort of spatial relation a little bit around Houghton. I don't know, sort of gives me a sense of that, maybe a little bit, yeah.
And right around the corner from that neighborhood was an example of a planned connection that has yet to be completed and where you will currently end up.
So this is a 4.3 meter wide travel lane where cars and bikes mix together.
Thankfully, shared lanes like this are no longer standard, and we soon found something a bit more chill.
So through here, we're basically into like a neighborhood bikeway kind of thing. Obviously very low density residential, low volume, low speed. Everybody could just sort of mix and match together.
These are great for filling out a cycling network, especially if budget is a concern. Even in the Netherlands, much of what you might call the cycling network is not made up of bike lanes, it is shared spaces. After passing what was the first bike lane in the city, we arrived at the university and began down towards the city center, which happened to be the perfect showcase of the evolution of cycling infrastructure in Nanaimo. Starting here with no separation, just a shared travel lane.
This is 4th Street, and once we cross that signal, you're going to start to see the evolution of bike facilities over the last decade and a bit in Nanaimo. We start with the bike lane on one side and a shared shoulder on, so sidewalk bike lane on the right for us, and a shared shoulder on the left. So this is the next evolution. So we've got a bit of a buffer here. And then on that side, we've got a mixed use area.
This is, again, sort of the more current iteration of what we'd be doing. Much bigger buffer on that side because cyclists, but not grade separated, because cyclists are so much more capable of running with car speeds through there. Normally, we'd want a slightly wider buffer between pedestrians, but because you're going uphill, you're obviously going so much slower, unless you got an e-bike, Mike. So this is kind of our last stretch into the heart of downtown, and it'll be kind of the inverse of what we saw there. It'll be buffered bike lanes in both directions. At that point, we will then have an improved cycling facility from downtown to the university. And so that kind of gives us our golden triangle between downtown, the university, and the hospital slash country club, and that's sort of like the core of central Nanaimo. So this is kind of the beginning of our main bike connection to the south. Okay. And so this is just a local road. Obviously, it's got the local road treatment to sort of tame everything down. Up here, we're doing something out of character for Nanaimo. We're creating a queuing street. What I mean by a queuing street is allowing parking on both sides with one travel lane in the middle. And the idea is that between driveways and fire hydrants and all of these bits and pieces, there's scenarios where a car can pull over, let the other one go by and sort of zigzag back and forth. Basically self-regulating speed, optimizes curb space for whatever you need, whether it's just general parking or loading zone or accessible parking.
These types of streets in Vancouver are often looked down upon, followed by calls for removing parking on one side of the street. But they serve a purpose, to slow traffic, and they do it pretty well. We eventually made it to the center of Nanaimo, a place they haven't ignored when it comes to modernizing the streets. In the very core of the city, along Commercial, you will see the simple daylighting and traffic calming that helps create a more inviting space. And here, along Front Street, half of the space that was once allocated to cars has been repurposed.
Before we started, this was a four-lane road, and we obviously looked at it and determined that it really doesn't need four travel lanes, and so we eliminated two of them, made one into parking and one into a protected bi-directional cycling facility, and it feels a lot better. I haven't seen traffic Mageddon. The volumes never justified the four-lane cross-section. It's balancing priorities, and you know, we hear a lot about, well, I never see bikes on the bike lane and around by the boat basin. We've actually got a counter, and this section is actually one of our highest used routes that we document. So between this and Metral and the E&N, this is still the busiest.
A giant thank you to Jamie, Mike, and Roy for giving me a tour. It was truly eye-opening. But I have to say, Nanaimo isn't Amsterdam. It's not even Vancouver. There are still gaps in the network. But what we're seeing are real, working examples of Dutch-style design right here in Canada, putting Nanaimo on track to become a top cycling city. And that matters because it shows three things. A, these new projects aren't just one-offs. They are part of the design standards, planned in from the start. Two, these designs can work in a North American context. And D, if Nanaimo can do it, so can other cities. When I left the Netherlands on my last trip, I said, we can do this in North America. And now, in Nanaimo of all places, they've gone and proved it.